good morning, church. So good to see you this morning. As you're coming in, welcome to church this Sunday morning at First Baptist Blanchard. We're so glad that you're here, and we are so happy just to see you this morning. As you can hear those bells, there's a reason for that. This morning, we have the honor and the privilege to baptize a couple of kids. And I'm so excited to see this morning. So would y'all look up to the baptistry?
Church family, it's always an honor and privilege to get to celebrate in baptism. This morning we have a brother and sister that I get to baptize. This is Kylie Ashby, and in just a moment I'm going to baptize Luke. And it's an honor and privilege to just watch them grow in their faith and relationship. They accepted Christ in Vacation Bible School and made their decisions for Christ. They're going to go to camp here in just a few weeks. So I would encourage you and challenge you and ask you as a church family, just be praying for them that God will keep working and moving in their hearts. And another thing, adults, you know, sometimes we forget the wonder of our salvation, don't we? We forget that special moment when God just changed our hearts and lives, and we forget the step that we took because maybe it was so long ago. But just live in that today. Just remember that special time in your own heart and in your own life. Kylie, in whom have you placed your faith and your trust?
Jesus.
In Jesus. Amen. God is precious. So in obedience commands of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, I baptize you, my sister. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, buried with Christ in baptism, raised to walk with brand new life in Christ. Congratulations. Come on, Luke. You stay right there so you can watch Luke. Y'all are awful quiet for how exciting this is. Luke, in whom have you placed your faith and your trust?
Jesus.
In Jesus. It's in obedience commands of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, buried with Christ in baptism, raised to walk with brand new life in Christ. Congratulations.
Amen. That's awesome. Amen. It is awesome to see a kid come to the Lord. The greatest testimony you can have is to say, I've lived for the Lord my whole life. I didn't have to go through what they went through. Amen. And so that is just an awesome thing to see, and we'll just keep praying for them as they take these next steps. So thank you so much again for being here this morning. Today's just a little bit different, and we're going to have at this time, Brother Ronnie's going to come up and give a testimony about their mission trip. If you didn't know, they just got back from Pueblo, Colorado. So he's going to give just a little bit about that.
Amen. Good morning. God is good. I want to share with you this morning. This is the beginning of Missions Emphasis Month, but Missions Emphasis is every day of our lives. So as you all know, I want to give you a greeting from Jamie and Wendy. They said, thank you. Tell the church, thank you for your love, your support, and your prayers. God's doing a work there in that mission field. We've been planning this trip for a while, and you know, it just kind of dwindled down a little bit, and Miss McKenzie right here gave us some encouraging words through a sheet that she gave us, and she said, on there, be flexible. And here's a word. She says, schedules and plans are made, but you never know what may change. Be open-minded and ready to serve with a happy and willing heart. Let me tell you some of the things that changed. The team was a little bit smaller than it was couple of years ago when we went. That changed. There wasn't as many kids that were there as it was a couple of years ago. That changed. Oakwood Estates, that villa where we're ministering to, has told them that effective in the fall, no more religious activities on those properties. That's changed. Let me tell you what hadn't changed. Jesus asked his disciples, who do they say I am? He said, who do you say I am? Peter said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. He said, Peter, flesh and blood didn't reveal that to you. Blessed are you, Simon Peter. You are a rock. And he said, I tell you this, on this rock I'll build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Let me tell you something. When you're working for the Lord and you're making progress, know this, and you know this, warfare is real. Spiritual warfare is real. The enemy is going to fight back. But I'm going to tell you right now, let me tell you some things that hasn't changed. Let me tell you some things. The power of God has not changed. You know that. Something that hasn't changed is opposition to the gospel. That hasn't changed. That's still here. And let me tell you something else that hadn't changed. That's the power of this word of God right here. You hear me? Let me tell you this. God says right here in Acts 1, it's right on that wall right out there. As a matter of fact, when you walk in, it says, "But you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and Judea and in Samaria and the uttermost parts of the earth." You know what the Apostle Paul said? "For I'm not ashamed of the gospel of God, Christ, because it is the power of God unto salvation to those who believe, and to the Jew first and to the Greek." Let me tell you something. The power of God fell on that place. There was three souls that were changed for the kingdom of God. Three more added to the kingdom of God. Let's see. Flip them right here. I'm going to show them to you. That's right there where we have some worship leaders right there that's leading in worship. Look at that. Isn't that awesome? Can you show me just another picture? You see right there? You know who those are? Those are our workers right there. Those are servants of God that fed us, and they come over there and they cooked hot dogs for that community right there. Let me see another picture. You see right there? That's the love of Jesus right there. Loving on a little old child that needs to be loved on. And that's why we went. We went to love on children, just like we loved on children, just like we saw today. Two little ones getting baptized in the name of Jesus right here. Let me tell you what that is. You see that? That's not a whole lot of little ones. But you know what? Where two or more gathered, Jesus said, "I'm in the midst." They got ministered to, and it was an awesome thing. Flip another one. I'll show you something. Can you show me another picture here? You see right here? You see that lady in the pink? And that lady right there beside her? Her little boy, his name is Hossier. Hossier got saved. Hossier come home from that time that he was led to the Lord, and he went and told his mama and his sister, and something was changed about him. And there he is right there, Hossier. And they wanted to come and see what's going on. It changed his life. You know what? And that's a sign right there. When the Lord's doing a work in your life, when somebody gets truly saved, listen to me, they want to go tell somebody. He wanted to go tell somebody. Went and told his mom and his sister. And you know, they came. And guess what? They heard the gospel. Hey, amen. Let me see. Well, look right here. I want to show you who this is right here in this picture. You see this lady right here? Her name is Angela. She got saved. You want to see the one, the second from the right, left right there? His name is Orion. He got saved. Orion says, "I don't have a Bible. Can you get me a Bible?" He wanted a Bible. And you see the little one right there on the far left? His name is Trey. Little bitty guy. Had an opportunity to witness to him. And I said, "Trey, how do you witness to an 8-year-old? Trey, you know what sin is? Trey, have you ever heard of the Garden of Eden? Where sin started in the garden? If that don't break your heart, what will? You will stand on the Lord and you tell me, and that whole bill of God ain't working. Tell me God ain't gonna work right there." That lady right there, she was wanting her kids to come to know the Lord, but she didn't know it. She got saved. She was under such conviction, she left out of that room. And my brother went to her. He led her to Jesus. Paul said in 1 Corinthians, "I have planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase." Let me tell you about some seeds that were planted. There were some college kids that were from Austin. My brother shared the gospel with him, shared the love of Jesus with him. At the hotel, there's a clerk that has a tattoo on her arm. My brother says, I love your tattoo. Well, and I know you got scripture. Do you know what that scripture says? I just like the tattoo. We shared to her what her scripture says that's on her arm. We read it to her. He only is my rock and my salvation. He is my defense. I shall not be greatly moved. She's wearing it right here. You see, there's a lot of cultural Christianity in this country. It is right here. My wife said it sounds like a foreign land. We're in Colorado. Right here. A young man that's campaigning to be a mayor of Pueblo. Jamie said, Are you a Christian? Yeah. Chris, my brother says, well, can you tell me of a time where Jesus changed your life? He couldn't go there. My brother shared the gospel with him. And my brother said, when you go back home today, will you ponder on all this that was said to you? Yes, sir. A man at a coffee shop from Croatia, Miss Dixie, he had us do a questionnaire, question where he is from. He said, are you a Christian? Yeah. 98% of the people in Croatia are Christian. That's cultural religion. There's a whole bunch of people in America that says they're Christian. That's cultural Christianity. Drove through a drive-thru shop. My brother uses these little cards that has like an optical illusion. One looks small, then you flip it up, it looks small. Shared the gospel with her. She says she's a believer. We stopped at a cook trailer on the way home, and a lady named Maria. They just Googled it. We want to find something to eat. A little cook trailer. Encouraged Maria in the gospel. Seeds planted all over the place. And kids at VBS. There's a little girl. I don't know if she's on there. Her name is River, and her mama, Alyssa. So hungry for God. The word says to go ye. Jesus said, before we get to that part, here's what he said. All power is given unto me in heaven and earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I've commanded you, and lo, I'm with you always, even unto the end of the world. Flip over till you see Bruce. You see that guy right there? 2 years ago when we went on that trip, for some of you that went year before last, Bruce right here got baptized. Jamie's discipling this guy. Jamie's discipling a guy named Bill that's running around there. Jamie's discipling others. This guy right here is so full of the Lord, he just wants to serve, and he didn't want to leave. He just wanted to hang around us. Bruce, go ye therefore and teach. When it says make disciples, there it is right there. God is at work over there. And it says baptize them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. That lady Angela, her little boy is going to get baptized. And Jamie was talking to her about baptism this month. And she said, Jamie, I'm going to get baptized too. And he said, do what? He didn't know it, but she got saved right outside them doors. She's going to get baptized. Little Javier is going to get baptized. 3 souls changed for the kingdom of God. Look, if you're in here and you was on this team this year, would you come up here? Would y'all? Whoever's in here, come up here, please. I want to show you something. I want to show you something. You see, there's Miss Dixie. Where's she at? Here you are. And then there's Tom and Sharon Ferguson that are on the road. There's Jim and Diane Walker. I don't see them. There's little Jimmy. But what I want you to see right here, y'all, we talk about unity in this church, unity for the kingdom of God. Look here what's represented right here, y'all. You see these young right here? That's youth. There's youth out there. That's you. You see these right here? These are parents. That's some of you. That's all of you. You see these right here? You see here? Here's some young. Here's some young plus. And some young, well, we don't go there. But you know what? Here's what you represent right here, y'all. The youth. The parents. And the grandparents. Nobody's left out. And I want you to see this. You see worship leaders in here. And you see painters. And you see landscape artists. And you see evangelists. And you see teachers. And you see people that love on people. You see the love of Jesus right here. And it was a blessing of a lifetime to be able to go on mission with y'all. And it's a blessing of a lifetime to go on mission with you. It's all good. I want to just, hey, does anybody want to say anything? Would anybody
want to say anything? She can't talk right now, crying.
I want to just close with this right here. And I'm going to rob it from Miss Dixie. Oh, I forgot to. There's a lot of encouragers right here. Encouragers. Little Jimmy. I said, Jimmy, I'm going to call you Barnabas. I'm going to call your middle initial B, JB. I didn't know it, but it's already JB. Little Jimmy Barnabas. Miss Dixie said this in a text yesterday. She said, we got some beautiful feet, some dishpan hands, some sore and painful joints. We have some, but we all have full and happy hearts. She says this, what a mighty thing to see the body of Christ at work. Amen. Our God.
and time is in His hands. Beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one. He's the Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. Would you stand with us and sing this? How great? How great is our God. Oh, sing with me. How great is our God. And oh, we'll see how great. How great is our God. And He has the name above. Sing this song together. It simply says, Jesus Messiah, He's the name above all names. He's worthy of our praise this morning. Amen. Come on, let's sing this together. Well, let's sing. He became sin. And He became sin. Who knew no sin, that we might become His righteousness. He humbled Himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing, His love so amazing. I'll sing this out, church. Jesus Messiah. Emmanuel. believe that this morning? Come on, church, let's sing.
Name above all names,
He is our Redeemer. Messiah, Lord of all. Amen. I'm just trying to be obedient, brother. I love it when God shows up. Amen. Thank you, brother, for your testimony and just an awesome to see God move like that. That's just cool. Amen. You may be seated. We're going to take up our offering at this time. As you know, this is Independence Day week, and I'm going to ask Craig Bond to come up and just pray for the offering, but also pray for us as a country as well. By the way, guests, we're so glad you're here, and we're just honored that you would be here and just to be a part of the service, and we just pray the Lord will bless you today. We don't want a thing from you. We just want you to be a part of the service. And home folk, First Baptist family, we're just going to be obedient to the Lord. So, Craig, would you pray for us?
Good morning. You know, you hear the story about Jamie and Wendy, what they're going through and not being able to share, and you think, oh man, we're being oppressed. We're not being oppressed. We have opposition, but we're not being oppressed. I can still wear my Men of Courage t-shirt. I can wear my Ken Freeman t-shirts. I listened to the testimony about 6 months ago of a gentleman that was a high priest in Islam that was converted, and what he went through. He went through a torture chamber of 9 different rooms and still never gave up his love for Christ. They're not free over there. Y'all were free. But they are free in a way. In Galatians 5:1, it says, "Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty by which Christ has made us free, and do not be entangled again with the yoke of bondage." So, yeah, over there, they're not going to grill hot dogs and hamburgers Tuesday. But they'll tell you they're free. They have that freedom. So, let's pray real quick. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you for a beautiful morning. Father, I thank you for those that are here. Thank you for our guests. Father, most of all, we just thank you for the freedom that we have. Yes, we thank you for those that fought and died for it. Just for those that live it every day, Father, and those that share it. We thank you that we have the freedom to share your word still over here without persecution, Father. And we just lift up our country to you. It seems like it's getting worse. But as you heard Brother Ronnie say, there's still more and more out there that want to hear your word, hear the gospel, Father. We just lift that up to you. Just let us be strong and brave to share that gospel. Father, we lift up our offering to you this morning. Father, just let it glorify you. Again, we thank you for all that you do. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
To wash away our shame from the scars.
your love released, salvation by a mercy tree. In the sky between two feet hung the blameless Prince of Peace. He's bruised and battered, scarred and torn, sacred head pierced by our thorns. It is finished, was his cry, the perfect Lamb is crucified. His sacrifice is our victory, our Savior chose the mercy tree. That violent day, the whole earth quaked at love's display. 3 days silent in the ground, his body born for heaven's crown.
That's good. So if you ever think about missing a Sunday, this is reason why not to miss a Sunday. You get to hear testimony like this of what God's done, and you get to hear the heart of somebody that's fired up and been on the mission field. You get to see folks that's gone and all that kind of stuff. And so if you have your Bibles, turn to 1 John 2:18 through 23. I always have some things that I put before the sermon and all that, but I can't do it today. I got to just jump in right where we are, because that song, if you were singing it, it just goes hand in hand with the message. And if you have your Bible, turn to 1 John chapter 2, verse 18. I can't wait on you. I'm going to have to start reading. Little children, it's the last hour. And as you've heard, that the Antichrist is coming. See, that what we just sang just a second ago, he's coming back. And those that know Christ, see, you're fired up right now. Those that were hearing those words and everything, you know your Redeemer's coming back for you. And so these scriptures that we read, they're truth and they're light and they're life. Little children, it is the last hour. We're going to talk about that a little bit more in a second. But here it is. In verse 19, they went out from us, but they were not of us. And if they had been of us, they would have continued with us. But they went out that they might be made manifest that none of them were of us. Verse 20, as we keep going. But you have an anointing. Amen? You have an anointing. Those that are born again from the Holy One. It's not from you, about you, about all that. It's from the Holy One that you have an anointing. And he tells us more, and I'll tell you more where it comes from. And you know all things. I have not written to you because you do not know the truth, but because you know it, and that no lie is of the truth. Who is a liar but the one who denies that Jesus is the Christ? He is Antichrist, who denies the Father and the Son. Whoever denies the Son does not have the Father either. He acknowledges the Son has the Father also. Father God, I pray you speak and move in our midst. God, you're already moving, you're already speaking. God, just continue to stir truth in our lives and in our hearts. God, if there's someone here today that doesn't know you as their Savior and Lord, let today be the day of salvation. God, we love you, we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. So I jump in really quick. John writes a warning that it's the last hour. John already knew it. The last hour is coming. I know you're looking at me and going, preacher, that was written way back when. We've lived 20, it's 2023. What are you talking about? We're in the last hour. We're in the last hour once Christ came, died, and rose again. There is a time period of grace. We're in the period right now of grace and redemption. You still have the power. You still have the drawing of the Holy Spirit to lead you and guide you into salvation. So therefore, we're in the last hour. There is a coming again, and when the second coming comes, it's going to be very few that's going to be saved during that time. And so right now, if the Holy Spirit of God speaking to you and salvation is knocking on your heart's door, today is the day of salvation. Today you need to give your heart and life while you can still speak. And I'm going to tell you this. I don't care if you say I chase rabbits and all that kind of stuff. I'm going to tell you some truth right now. Here's some truth. There's a guy in a hospital right now. Right now as I'm speaking, right now as I'm speaking. A few years ago, the Holy Spirit of God was speaking to his life, and you know what? He ignored that call. He said, one day, you know what? I'll know when it is when I'm ready to give my life. I'll sow some oats. I'll do this and I'll do that. But you know what? I'll do it on my terms and my timetable. And you know what? The time's come. He's in the last hours of life, and you know what? He's not done it yet. I'm going to tell you right now, when the Holy Spirit of God draws you to salvation, you need to respond. You don't know when your mind is going to be capable enough to repent, to turn, to understand Scripture, to understand those different things. But I'm going to tell you right now, when the Spirit moves, you need to move with Him. So last warning, the last hour is coming. John, he gave us an imperative last week. He told us this. Do not love the world or the things in the world. See, that's what happens. A lot of times people get held on to the world. They want one foot in the world and maybe a half a foot in the church and all this thing. He's telling us with an imperative. That's a direct command from the Scripture. Do not love the world or the things in the world.
Because I'm going to tell you right now, the world will pull you and drag you in. The world will give you all kind of shiny things, all kind of like this. Here, I'm going to throw it to you. He'll give you all these shiny, great things. He'll give you money and wealth and all these different things. You know why? To distract you. You know why he wants to distract you? Because he is the great deceiver. He comes to steal, kill, and destroy. My God comes to give life and life more abundant. But it's all through him, by him, and in him. That's faith. For by grace you've been saved through faith. It's not works. It ain't any kind of good things you can do. There ain't enough good things your sorry self can do. But God can. God can take a sinner and turn him into a saint. Ain't God good? That's what he's done in our lives and these different things. So he gives us that direct command, and now he gives us a warning. So there's a direct command before this. He says, don't get caught up in this world. And then right after it, he says, warning. I grew up in a time where there was a show, I forget the name of it, but it was Will Rogers. He says, warning, Will Rogers. I remember the show. Y'all remember what it was? Lost in Space. There you go. Warning, Will Rogers. Hey, let me tell you right now, Jesus saying right now, warning, warning, the days are coming to an end. You better be ready. You better be ready. There's a direct warning. Every day from now till Jesus comes is the last days. You only have, and we only have, so much time. If we could put up a countdown right now, which we're not going to do it, I know we live in this digital age now and all this kind of stuff. My watch still has a third hand maybe or whatever on it that ticks. Ticks. Time is ticking. Time is ticking. We're in the last days. I'm going to tell you right now, you're one heartbeat away from eternity. One time on that hand of that clock. You know how fast it is? The Bible says it's faster than the twinkling of an eye. And I can't even tell you how fast that is. It was pretty quick. He's going to come back. And even in that time frame right now where you sit in this church and those that are online that are listening to the voice and everything, you're one heartbeat away. You're one message away. You're one breath away from all of eternity. It's time. This time period, grace, redemption, salvation before it's too late. See, the apostle thought it could be in their time frame. See, these apostles, these epistle letters that were written, Paul that wrote so many of them, which was 13 of them. John pens 3. I mean, there's so many of them that are written. You know what? They thought at any minute, John, that Jesus could come right back. Let me tell you something. It could be today. I have a dear friend of mine. His name's Jim Average. He sends me a text of encouragement every day. And a lot of times, Craig, he puts CBT. It took me a minute. I was like, what's he talking about? You know, he's getting a little age on him, right? You know, he's getting a little old. I'm like, you know, these kids, you know, if you text and all that and you get these little, I don't know half of what all that stuff stands for. So I'm blonde, Emily, where, you know, I told her a minute ago, you blonde, you burn easy. I'm blonde. I'm not that sharp. And so I had to ask him. I was like, Jim, what is CBT? And he said, could be today. And you know what I said? I gave him some Hebrew. I said, Maranatha. That means come quickly, Lord Jesus. I'm ready to go. Time's short, dude. You better be knowing where you're going to spend all of eternity. Because he told us, and this was written in probably about 75, 90 A.D. after the death of Christ. It was written somewhere right in there. And he's thinking right then, hey, it could be today. It could be today. We don't know the last hour. We don't know the times. But I'm going to tell you right now, one day he's coming back. And let me ask you, are you ready? Because see, I don't even know why I didn't even really plan this. I was reading in my quiet time, and I wanted to give you some Hebrews. It says this in 10:35, therefore do not cast away your confidence, which has a great reward, for you have need of endurance. Craig jokingly said, I come up the stairs and I got to the mic and he said, I couldn't hardly breathe. You know what? We got to stay ready in endurance. I'm just picking on Craig because I love Craig. But he says, don't cast away. You need endurance. Why am I saying that? Hebrews said there is a great cloud of witnesses cheering you on to finish your race. It's not finished, y'all. Just because you know Jesus and you've accepted him as Savior and Lord, the race isn't over. It's just beginning. And he's saying with this confidence, so that after you've done the will of God, you may receive the promise. I love that. I love this phrase right here because it ties into this message. For yet a little while. You see, to Jesus, God, who stands outside of time and space, like you're tripping right now because it's going to be like, man, we may not get out of here at 12 o'clock today. We may not get out of here till 1. You know what? Jesus, God himself, he lives outside of time and space. What does that mean, Annalise? That means that he doesn't think like we think. We think 2023, Jesus is coming back today. Why is he tarrying? What's going on? He ain't coming back. That's what a lost Colorado world thinks. That's what a lost, you know, world out there thinks. But I'm going to tell you right now, Jesus is coming back soon. He's getting us ready, and he's getting the church ready, and he's getting different people ready for what's going to happen and what's transpiring. And he says this, for yet a little while. That's good news. A little while. See, I'm 50 years old. Hey, y'all, Kirk just turned 30 today. He thinks he's old. He thinks he's old. Yeah, you think you're old. You're eight. Man, I thought I was old, too. Yeah, I know Lloyd. Lloyd's 80. He just said, you ain't there either yet, young buck, at 50. But see, 2023 seems like a long time. But see, to God, a day is a thousand years, and a thousand years is one day to the Lord. Time, he stands outside of time and space. 12:30 today doesn't mean anything to him. 4:45 this afternoon doesn't mean anything to him. He stands outside of time and space, but one thing does matter to him. There is an hour and a day that man doesn't know when he's coming, but God the Father knows. preacher? See, Chris, before that, you know, they look me in the face and say, you really believe that, Chef? I'd be like, yeah, I believe it. Because God said it, I believe it. But it's better than that. God said it, and that's just it. That's called sovereignty of God. He's it. I just get to repeat what he says. So John warns the last hour. Next, John writes that there are some that are deceived. And you see that in verse 19. He tells them, they went out from us, but they were not of us. I just kind of want to talk about this for a little bit, because many of them are false teachers. If we're looking at John in the context of what's going on, they're teaching this false gospel, this false truth, and all these different things. But here's the deal. And look, I know y'all sitting here going, you're a geek. You really read all that Greek and try to understand the context? I do, because I don't want to teach it wrong, understand it wrong, and all this. The text is this. You study Greek too, you know it. The text is this. They once were with us, teaching, proclaiming. They were in John's circle. They were tight. They were part of his organization that was going out there. And so they were once with us, teaching, proclaiming, and all that kind of stuff. You know what that tells me? Inside the church, there are many lost people. There are many deceived people. There are many people that hear the teaching or around the teaching, sometimes give an amen to the teaching, sometimes sing in choir, sometimes do different things and all like that. But he's telling us really close, they left us. Or the Greek uses it like this, from us they went out. From us, we went doing mission work together. We were on the mission. We were going out there teaching and saying these things. But it was clear to John, and it was clear to that local body, that they were teaching the wrong things. They weren't teaching the same message, and you know what had to happen? They had to part ways. They parted ways. They did do life together, but doctrine revealed that they were not believers of the message. They didn't believe the message. They didn't believe what was going on, and it was just time for them to part ways. He said, they were not of us. They weren't of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. They weren't of the teaching. They would have continued if they were with us, if they were in that word and they were in that doctrine that they taught and things that they knew. But here's where it just keeps getting better and better. Because if you look at the bottom of it, you see they would have continued with us, but they were not, but they went out that they might be manifest. That word's pretty good right here. That manifest means it was plain. It was plain that they weren't from us. It was plain that they didn't understand the doctrine, who Jesus was. It was very clear what was going on. And the revelation or their character revealed what was on the inside. You see, we can put on masks and all these kind of things, and we can look one way, but it's what's on the inside is what matters. And they didn't have the real thing on the inside. It was plain that their character revealed none of them were of us. The character revealed. So I'm going to give you a quick illustration. I know I'm running out of time because y'all stand inside time and space. God stands outside. But I'll give it to you really quick. You remember this guy named Herod when Jesus was born? He was the king. And the wise men came, and they came to Herod just, you know, just kicking it. They just came to talk to him and everything, and they said, hey, there was a star, and it was out there, and this star reveals that there's a Savior being born in Bethlehem. You know, they give him the T on everything. They're telling him about what's going on. And Herod puts on this face, and he says, hey, King of Israel, eh? He's out there? Well, I'm the king. Some young buck's going to take my spot? I'm paraphrasing. And so he says, hey, when you find him, let me know. Let me know exactly where he's at and everything, because I might want to go bring him a gift or something. I might just want to go say hi. I might want to go follow that star. No, because see, I'm gonna give you scripture, because y'all looking at me like I don't know. I'm paraphrasing. I'm crazy. Matthew 2:7 says this, then Herod, when he had secretly called the wise men, determined from them what the time when the star appeared. And then it goes further in Matthew 2:13. Now, when they had departed, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream, saying, "Arise, take the young child and his mother, flee to Egypt, and stay there until I bring you word, for Herod will seek the young child to destroy him." See, Herod put on a face, and he made it sound like he was part of them, but he wasn't part of them. He wanted to kill him. See, that's kind of what this scripture is trying to tell us right here. They weren't from us. They weren't of us. Therefore, we had to part ways. John warns them the last hour. John writes there are some of them that are deceived. Number three, John writes because some have denied the truth. And you look at it in 23. He says, whoever denies the Son does not have the Father either. So there's many that are denying. Again, you got to go back to why is this little letter written? It was written to let folks know that there are some false believers out there. There's false followers that believe. And he's exposing them. He's just exposing them. From here all the way to chapter 5, we're going to see him exposing their character. He's exposing their false walk, their false antichrist. He's exposing all these different things that's going on in their life. So as we read it, he tells us this. Who is a liar but he who denies that Jesus is the Christ? He is the antichrist. Who denies the Father and the Son? Whoever denies the Father, whoever denies the Son does not have the Father. So he gives us this clear evidence. Who is a liar but he who denies Jesus as the Christ? Whoever denies the Son does not have the Father. He makes it clear. Again, that's that dualistic description that John gives us, the followers of Christ. The followers are true in the Word. They're true to what's written. And see, John also knows, because he wrote under the divine revelation of the Holy Spirit, he walked with Jesus. Y'all know that? John walked with Jesus some 3.5 years, and he penned as Jesus talked. And some of it was just put on his heart, some of it was put in his mind, and then he wrote it down. But he wrote these 7 I am statements, which are metaphors for Jesus while Jesus was on the earth. He says, I am the bread of life. In John 6, if you want homework, you can go look those things up. I am the light of the world, John 8. I am the door of the sheep. I am the good shepherd. Both of those are found in John 10. I am the resurrection and the life, John 11. I am the way, the truth, and the life, John 14. If you want to get a little bit closer, John 14, 6. Then I am the vine. So John knows, without the shadow of a doubt, that Jesus is the Son of God. You want a little bit more homework? Go to Genesis 1:1. He tells us. You want some more? Go to John 1:1. He says, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was God. The Word was with God. He tells us clear that there is a Trinity and that Jesus is part of the Trinity. He is part of what's going on in God's plan. And then the best word you want to hear today? Finally, huh? Finally, he's going to wrap it up. We're getting to the end. Finally, John gives good news for the ones who know the truth. See, I know the truth. You know the truth. You that are born again, those that have put their hope and trust in Jesus, you know the truth. You know those 7 I am statements. You know these different things. He also, because I skipped a few verses, and you might be thinking you skipped some, but verse 20 and 21 says this, but you have an anointing from the Holy One, and you know all things. I have written to you because you do not know the truth, but because the truth is in you, and that no lie is of the truth. So we're just going to look just a second. True believers have an anointing. You know what that anointing is? The Holy Spirit. True believers have trusted in God to have the Holy Spirit that lives within them. True believers have an anointing. Let me ask you this morning. Do you know beyond a shadow of a doubt the Holy Spirit lives within you? You can today. But he tells us this in Hebrews 10, 15 and 16. But the Holy Spirit also witnesses to us. For after he said before, this is the covenant that I will make with them. After those days, says the Lord, I will put my law into their heart and into their mind, and I will write it on them. See, we have the law. We have the things. The Holy Spirit puts it on our heart and on our mind. We know when we mess up because the Holy Spirit convicts us and He shows us. That is that anointing that's inside there. You have an anointing. It's the Holy Spirit that draws us. We know Him. We know the truth. I'm going to have to skip it up and move a little bit quicker because time's running out. But just because this time right now is running out, yet in a little while, Jesus is coming. Are we ready? Are you ready? Are you ready for when He comes back? Let me ask you something. Do you know the truth? Does the truth live within you? John 8:32 says this, "And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free." Isn't that good news? When you know Him and that Holy Spirit of God lives within you, you're free. Free indeed. But does that mean that I'm going to go out there and sin all that more? Paul clears that up for you too. No. That just means I'm being transformed and made and shaped more into the image of Christ. The things that I once wanted to do, I no longer want to do them. Why? Because that Holy Spirit now lives within us. He leads us, guides us, directs us. It's our conscience. He speaks to us. So let's do this. Let's have a time of invitation. Let's have a time of examining. Am I in Christ or am I opposed to Christ? Have I fully put my faith and my trust in Him? Or am I still trying to play this game of a little bit of church, a little bit of the world, sow some wild oats, play this game, play that game? There's no playing a game with Jesus. It's either you're all in or you're all out. No middle ground. It's not I'm 95% wanting to be a Christian, 95% I'm a follower. It's all in or all out. Let's do this. Let's stand. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Let's just examine our lives just for a few minutes. We got plenty of time. We got plenty of time. There's nobody in here wanting to rush anything. It's a time of self-examination. A time to see, am I in Christ or am I out? Have you confessed the Son so that you have the Father? John just kept repeating that over and over to us. If you haven't confessed Jesus as Lord and believed in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you haven't been born again. Go look at Romans 10:9-10. But if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord, believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you shall be saved. You know. You know. Father God, this is your time of invitation. Lord, if there's someone here that needs to respond to the gospel in obedience, God, I pray that they take those steps. That they understand through the power of the Holy Spirit's revelation, revealing to them that they're lost and they need a Savior. So, Father, we thank you for what you're doing and what you're going to do. We ask it all in Jesus' name. Let me ask you something. Do you need to be born again? These guys right here, they'll talk you through, they'll walk you through what it means to be born again. Here's another one. Is there just somebody in the house? You just say, man, me and my brother or sister in Christ, we may just have some ought against each other. We may just have a little tension in between us. Let's work all that out and be in unity and love one another. Let the love of Christ flow out of us. If you're looking for a church home that you want to join and be actively involved in, just come talk to these guys. They'll tell you what it looks like. You just be obedient to whatever the Lord's saying to you.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. Your Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. So leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. And bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Thank you, Brother Kurt. Hey, if you just be seated for a quick second, I promise I won't be long. I just want you to see something really fast. You see this right here? This is a ministry that's out there that we have partnered with as a church. This is Missions Emphasis. I just kind of want you to be aware what's happening. The elementary and a sister church contacted us and said, hey, there are folks that need food, and especially, you know, during the summertime where they're not going to school and they need food and different things. Well, we have become this hub where we can get this food out to some of these families. There's 20 families that we have as a church that are identified and need food and different things. And so this is what the food pack. I know some folks asked me, what does the pack look like? How does it come? It looks just like a shoebox. So we need folks that will deliver these to the home. It's not where you just come in and we're giving you food or something like that. We're intentional. We want to bring the food to them. We want to get to know the family. We want to meet them. We want to talk to them and share Jesus if he opens the door and share the good news of Christ. But you go twice out of the month, and for every kid that's in the home, there's a shoebox. And they give them some. We give them some food for that period of time. We're not doing it for an indefinite amount of time. It's about a 5 to 6 months period where we're just trying to give them a hand up and trying to just work with them. First off, we want to get their relationship with Christ right first. We want to see where they are with him and give them that time. And then we give them the food. And so if you're interested in partnering with us and partnering and what's going on, when I say us, we as the staff know what's going on. We were able to meet with them and talk to them. Us is the church. But if you want to partner in and give some of those food boxes away, see Brother Andrew. He'll tell you what all it looks like. I'll talk to you. We'll walk through it. But we want to share the love of Christ, and sometimes we have to meet the physical to get to the spiritual. Amen. All right, let's stand. We'll be dismissed. Father, we thank you for another day you've given us. Lord, I thank you for your Holy Spirit. Lord, I thank you for your word. I know it doesn't return back void. There's folks that are dealing with salvation right now. They're wrestling with it. Am I in? Am I out? Lord, you know the heart. You know what's going on. So, Father, if there's someone still needs to talk about salvation, Lord, let them know that today is the day of salvation. Let them not put it out, put it off or anything like that. God, move. God, I thank you for everything you're doing. God, I pray you bless this group that's in here today, those that are listening online. Lord, just give us a good week in your presence. Help us to abide in you as you abide in us. In Jesus' name, amen. Mm-hmm.